hey family, welcome to Ashley Ridge at home or on the go. My name is James. I'm the worship and creative director here at Ashley Ridge, and I'm glad that you're here because this is week five, the final week of our Joseph series, What to Do When Life Goes Wrong. And this week, we're going to be talking about forgiveness, which is something that we all need, and this is a message that we all need to hear. Don't want you to forget that every Sunday at 10 a.m., we are in person at the high school, whether you're a student or whether you're an AR kid or little, or even whether you're an adult. We have things specifically for you from 10 to 11 o'clock. So bring a chair and come out and join us. As you probably know, we are in the middle of our 40-day push to burn the note on our land so that we can begin construction next year. And we recently had the family meeting. If you missed that, go to our YouTube page. You can see it in its entirety there, where we revealed the floor plans and the site plan for our new home base for ministry. And here's a quick video that we want you guys to see with Pastor Jen. Y'all check this out.
When Ashley Ridge Church launched a little over 10 years ago, we had one expectation, that God would show up, and He did. It's been incredible to watch over these last 10 plus years how God has allowed us to put a kitchen on wheels and to build circles where we were creating community and loving people well. We've prayed for healing and we've seen it happen. We've worshiped in some really exciting ways, and God showed up through all of it. But if we've learned anything in the last 7 months, it's that things can often change fast, really fast. In February, we came to you as a church with plans. We had everything put together and laid out this year for how things were going to work financially and how we were going to move forward with finishing to pay for the land and then working with architects and engineers. We had plans for a surge, and we did a 21-day fast leading into that surge. And then the world stopped. Everything changed overnight. Our kids came home from school, and they stayed home. Everything shut down, and we wondered what was going to happen next. But God still showed up. In fact, God showed up in ways that surprised and amazed us. In just 1 week, we moved every one of our environments, our worship, our kids, our students, our small groups, into virtual online spaces. And we watched as God continued to show up in the midst and do things beyond what we could have ever imagined. And then just a few weeks ago, we baptized 9 people in the rain in a pool. And it was a reminder that God's grace was all over us. We found ways to meet with our kids and our students during one of the most upsetting periods of their life. God showed up. But one thing has become incredibly obvious, and it's that Ashley Ridge needs a house. Not for us. We need a house for our friends, for our community, for our neighbors, for people who need the work that we're going to continue to do and grow and stretch and point to the hope that we have in Jesus. Ashley Ridge needs a house that's going to act as a home base so that we can stretch farther and dig deeper together. But it's not just that Ashley Ridge needs a house. It's that Summerville needs a home. Summerville needs a home because we need somewhere to invite our friends and neighbors to come in, a place where they can meet each other and meet God, a place to hear the word of God, to experience the love of a volunteer and the sounds of their community singing and praying together. Summerville needs a home because we need to teach our children that there's a great big God And that God wants to know them because he loves them unconditionally and permanently. Summerville needs a home because there are people in our neighborhoods and communities that are hungry. And some of them are hungry for a warm meal, but a lot of them are hungry even more for a friend. Someone who wants to sit across from them and hear their story. We need a house because Summerville needs a home. You've heard me say it and others say it 100 times and even 1,000 times before. And we believe that now is our moment. This land that I'm standing on right now, we can finish paying for it over the next couple of weeks. And we can do that together. And it's not gonna be because of any individual or because we figured it all out. It's gonna be because once again, God shows up, just as he's done 1,000 times before. In my hands are the official plans, floor plans, master plans for the house that we're gonna build right here. A place where our neighbors, our friends, our kids, and their kids someday are gonna gather and they're gonna hear the name of Jesus. It is time and we are gonna move that mountain. The plan is in front of us. But more than just showing you, we want you to look at them, think about them, pray with us over them. Here's where you go to subscribe to building updates at forsummerville.com. And when you subscribe, here's what's gonna happen. You're not only gonna get regular updates about everything that's happening, but you're gonna get a copy of the plans so that you get to see how God is already showing up. But here's the thing, we need you. Because in this crazy way, God invites us to be part of how he shows up in this world. And so we need you to come alongside us in this moment and give. And it's not about what large number any one of us gives. It's about all of us jumping in and giving what we can together to make this a reality. Sometime very soon in the coming weeks, we're going to burn the note on this land. And when we burn the note, we ignite the future. God is showing up. Will you be part of it with us? We've been hanging out with Joseph for several weeks now. His is a great story. It's one that teaches a lot of lessons. And one of the things I love about it is we really get more of Joseph's story than we get a lot of the stories of people in scripture. So we kind of get to follow him for a little longer than just a moment. And what has made Joseph so particularly helpful right now is that so much went wrong in his life. And so he's been this good traveling companion because in a year when it feels like wrong stuff just keeps happening, it's led us to the conversation of what do we do when life goes wrong? Because even though I think we've all had lots of moments, myself certainly included, where we felt like just throwing up our hands in the air and saying, never mind. We've talked about when we change the clocks at the end of the month, whether we should just roll those things right on forward about 4 months into a new year. But those aren't really good solutions. We've got to work the problem instead of letting the problem work us. And so here we are having this conversation of what do you do when life goes wrong. We've talked about things like finding the good and maintaining integrity and staying steady. And I hope you caught it last week when we talked about the idea of growing thicker skin. having thicker skin so we're not so easily and readily offended. And in doing that, we get to protect our heart. We get to maintain a heart that's willing to be compassionate and show mercy in this world. Well, I hope you're ready, because today we've made it to the last thing we're going to take from Joseph's story of what to do when life goes wrong, and it's a good one. Here it is. Find a goat and make him pay. Y'all, go ahead. I'll wait for a second. Write that down. Find a goat and make the goat pay. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? I'm talking about a scapegoat. When life goes wrong, you need someone to blame. You need someone you can pin it on. You need someone you can be mad at and fuss about. Come on now, I'm not the only one out there. You need a place to take all of the anger and the frustration and put it. Now, historically speaking, we have referred to this process as scapegoating. But I want to tell you this morning that that whole idea of a scapegoat actually comes directly from the Jewish scriptures. It comes directly from the Old Testament and this way of life and sacrifice that God had with his covenant people of Israel. And so if I take you all the way back to a book I'm sure that we've all spent lots of time in, it's the book of Leviticus. In Leviticus, it's early on in the life of God's people, and Moses, a guy you might be familiar with, he had a brother named Aaron, and Aaron was the priest over the people. And so the temple wasn't built yet, so it was more of a tent, it was a tabernacle, but it was where they centered their life of faith with God. And they had all these different rituals around sacrifice, when you needed a pigeon, when you needed a goat, when you needed a bull, how it was all supposed to go down. Okay, so just remember, we're talking about a different world and different kinds of practices. But what happens is, as all of this is getting explained to Aaron and to Moses early on, God tells him, there's going to be a sacrifice that you make every year. It's still celebrated in Jewish tradition as Yom Kippur, but is this Day of Atonement. And when this day comes, you're not only going to take a bull and sacrifice it, and there's lots of other things around that, but you're also supposed to take two goats. Okay, now this is really important, not one goat. It's really important that there were two goats. And what would happen is that Aaron would take these two goats to the front flap of the tent of meeting, and there he was supposed to cast lots. This was really important, and the goats were really nervous when this was happening, because he was supposed to cast lots, and then that would determine which of the goats was going to be sacrificed for the sins of the people, and which of the goats, so the other goat, was going to be the goat who would live and would effectively become the scapegoat. Now, the Hebrew word that was used for this, the goat who lived, all right, some of you are thinking about Harry Potter and the boy who lived. This is the goat who lived. And the Hebrew word for the goat who lived was Azazel. Azazel. And it meant for absolute removal. And eventually over time, this word was adapted into Latin, and then it became a word for an escape goat, literally, because this is what would happen with this Azazel, this goat meant for absolute removal. After they would sacrifice the first goat, I'm in Leviticus 16, if you're following along here, in verse 20, it says, when Aaron has finished making atonement for the most holy place, the tent of meeting in the altar, he shall bring forward the live goat, the Azazel. And he is to lay both hands on the head of the live goat. I really wish I had a live goat right now and could do this for y'all. He is to lay both hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the wickedness and the rebellion of the Israelites, all of their sins, and put them on the goat's head. You picture it, this goat's just like, man, having a day. And, you know, suddenly Aaron's got his hands on the goat, and all the wickedness, all the rebellion, all the sins are being confessed directly onto this goat's head. He shall send the goat away into the wilderness in the care of someone who has been appointed for the task. And the goat will carry on itself all their sins to a remote place, and then the man shall release it in the wilderness. All right, y'all got that? When life goes wrong, get you two goats, and the first one, sacrifice, and the second one, put your hands on it, confess everything, and send it off. Okay, clearly, this is no longer how our life with God works. There's a reason there's a difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament, this new covenant that Jesus made with us. But this is really helpful background. This is really helpful background to help us understand how we've gotten to some of the places we've gotten, and even more so, how we've confused some of these ideas. Because you and I both know the term scapegoat because it's something we do today. You didn't know you were doing it because of this tradition, maybe, but we have this practice of looking for someone to blame. But here's the thing that is really different, and this is a crucial difference between where it started and where we are now. Before they sent the scapegoat into the wilderness for that overarching all of their sins, did you catch that? All of the wickedness. This was like a catch-all, all right? This goat that was sacrificed, and I mean, the one that was sacrificed was for the sins and especially for their own sins. But this second one, this was the all-encompassing sin goat. So the overarching, all of their sins are placed onto this. And then they would, but before they did that, they would sacrifice the first goat for their own sins. Now, two things have happened as time has gone on. We've altered the scapegoat practice to skip the first goat and to hang on to the second goat. You see, we skip the first goat so many times because when life goes wrong, the last thing we want to do is take responsibility for the wrongness. We don't want to start by figuring out what role we might have played in getting where we are. Sometimes we get there eventually, but it's not usually our first instinct. Help me here. This tends to be how we function. We try to see how many other pieces can we parcel off to somewhere else. But I think it was really important that the first goat was always meant to be for the atonement of their own sins. And if we skip that step and we run straight to the second goat, then we miss the opportunity to deal with ourselves. When life goes wrong, y'all, sometimes life happens and things happen to us and we didn't see it coming and we didn't mean for it to happen. Sometimes we had no part in how it happened. And it can be so hard and so frustrating. But so many times when things go wrong, we need just at least a moment to go, where am I in this? What may I have done, or what role have I played in where we are right now? My family's in trouble. These relationships are suffering. Is there something I've contributed to this misunderstanding? Is there something I've contributed to this mess? We ask ourselves these questions not to beat ourselves up. Okay, this is what I love about this practice, is it's a moment of saying, we're going to let it go. That first goat's getting sacrificed so that you walk away from that place and it's finished. And when we skip this step, we skip the opportunity to deal with these pieces, to be truthful about these pieces. Okay, but let me keep going here because y'all, I don't want to lose you in the goats, okay? So, we skip the first goat. But then what happens is we get to the second goat, the scapegoat, and we get the part about the, I'm going to put all the blame on its head. I'm going to accuse it of everything. I'm going to make sure there is someone who is at fault for all of this. And then we hang on to it. Instead of sending the scapegoat, literally the escape goat that is meant to have all those things and then be let go into the wilderness to literally take those things with it, we hold on to it. We find a goat to blame and we hang on to the goat. And what this does, and you guys know this story, is it keeps us from forgiving other people. It keeps us not only from dealing with ourselves, but from letting go of the hurts and the things that have come from other people. And at the end, both scenarios perpetuate the problem and they leave us stuck. When life goes wrong, for lots of different reasons, we end up frustrated, mad, angry, but we don't have to stay there. And one of the things I take comfort in is, y'all, it's not a bad thing to be there. It's okay to be hurt and to be angry about things you may have lost this year. It's okay to be frustrated with circumstances in our world, with things that aren't as they should be. In fact, there's a righteous anger to some of those things. It's okay to be there, but God didn't leave us there. And so I want to continue this conversation past the goats with you this morning. It's really important we understand about these goats, but God is going to introduce a better way that accomplishes these same ends. And this is what takes us back to our friend Joseph. And this is all the way at the end of his story, the final chapter of Genesis, this book that's about the beginning of our story and relationship with God and with God's people and how we live life together. We get to this final chapter of Joseph's story where he's been through all these hardships and he's seen famine and imprisonment and abandonment and isolation and being in places that are unfamiliar. He's been tempted and he's been tried to be killed. That's a bad way to say that, but he's experienced all of these things. But he's also seen God at work through all of it. And we get to the end of his story and his father Jacob has just died. And the brothers who were the cause of so much of Joseph's early life trauma and issues are now concerned that even though they've had years now since they've been reunited and things are fine, there's a song about that too, they've been reunited and life was going well and Joseph had accepted them and they were a family again. But when their dad died, they thought, this is the moment it all falls apart. What if Joseph was just giving us a pass for the time being for the sake of our father, Jacob? And now that Jacob's gone, all that Joseph has been holding on to is going to come back to haunt us. But what Joseph does in this moment and how he deals with this wrongness is so critical for you and for me. I don't want us to miss this lesson. So I'm in Genesis chapter 50, the last chapter, starting in verse 15. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs that we did to him?" In other words, what if he's holding on to the goat? So they sent a word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died." So this is their first plan. Let's lie. All right. This is a note that dad passed to us before he was gone. It says, "This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." And when their message came to him, Joseph wept. Now we don't know if Joseph wept because he felt like he was getting these final words from his father, or if he was weeping because he knew that they were false and his brothers hadn't learned the lessons that he had hoped they had learned in all these years, or if he was just still broken that they would think he was still holding on to so much anger so many years later. But it says that he heard this and he wept. And his brothers then came and they threw themselves down before him and said, "We are your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God?" Is that an interesting question? We're going to come back to that in a minute. But he looks at them and he says, "Do you think I'm God? Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, which is the saving of many lives. Because Joseph was in that place of power, because God had used him to interpret Pharaoh's dreams, they had food supplies that were carrying them through these long years of famine. He says, you intended this for harm, but God intended it for good. Look around you right now. God is using this very thing to save many lives. So then, and he repeats himself, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and he spoke kindly to them. So in other words, he says, not only am I going to provide for you, not only did I not hold on to this until dad was gone, but it goes to your children. There's no grudge that's being helped and kept that's going to be passed on from generation to generation. How many of us have been stuck in generational hurts over grudges and things that have been passed along so far that we've even forgotten where they started, but we're holding on? Joseph said, don't be afraid. You and your kids, it's good. And he spoke kindly to them. What Joseph does in this moment, where it would have been so easy to claim the scapegoat, it would have been so easy in this moment for Joseph to say, that's right, you guys caused it all. You guys made my lives miserable. Now dad's gone. I can do whatever I want. I've got the power. And you guys are in so much trouble. And instead, Joseph shows us a better way. You know, when things go wrong, you can let that be the narrative that finishes your story. Because shortly after this, Joseph dies. He knows he's writing the final chapters of his life. What is the story you're going to write with your life? What's the narrative? What's the prevailing piece that's going to carry through? And Joseph said, it's not going to be this thing that you did to harm me. The story of my life isn't going to be caught up on everything that went wrong. Instead, Joseph brings to the forefront the idea of truth and grace and forgiveness. This idea of truth, remember goat number one? What is it that happened here? Do we understand? Have we taken responsibility and set it down? And Joseph looks at them in that moment and he says, yeah, you intended this for harm. Let's just be honest about that. Years ago, you didn't have this great master plan of how this was all going to work out. God did, but you guys did this to harm me. But you see how quickly then, and even in looking at that truth, Joseph goes to this idea of, but God. You intended this to harm me, but it's not the end of the story. What you did and what I did and what happened in between, that's not the end of the story. But God writes the story. God decides. God leads. God makes a way. We are living in a bigger story of the creator of the universe. Joseph says, but God. And he moves so quickly from that truth piece right into that grace piece, where he says, look how many lives are being saved. Do you see how this thing that you did, God rewrote the pieces? God reorchestrated the mess into the miracle? Y'all, some of us, God is wanting nothing more than to reorchestrate our mess into a miracle, but we're too busy holding on to the pieces. We're too busy holding on to the mess to put it in the hands of the master so that he can orchestrate it to his good ends. Joseph says, don't miss this. This is what God does in our lives. What we intended for evil, God turns to good. And he uses it for the saving of many lives. And so Joseph walks through this truth and he walks through this grace. And then he moves right into this place of forgiveness. He says, so then, don't be afraid. I'm going to provide for your kids. I'm going to speak kindly to you. There's provision, there's reassurance, and there's kindness. Can we speak honestly? We're on a screen, so it's okay. We're really bad at forgiveness. And I'm using a big generalized stereotype here, and I hope some of you are better at it than some of us, and certainly me. We're not so good at forgiveness, and for some of it's because we struggle with holding on. Holding on to some of the pieces because we're not sure how to frame our lives without it. And for some of us, we struggle with forgiveness because we wanna stop holding on, but we don't know how to move on from that place. And y'all, this is where I just come back to this idea that forgiveness is never an us alone thing. It's something that God gives us so that we can then give to others. Forgiveness isn't something we can conjure on our own. It comes from this very different place. And this is where we need to go back to Joseph's question that he asks before this. I love this. You cannot miss this. Okay, if you learn nothing today, remember the goats and this question. He says, am I in the place of God? You guys are asking me for forgiveness. You're asking me for forgiveness. Am I in the place of God? In other words, you need what God gives. And just like God used Joseph to interpret dreams, and just like God used Joseph to save many lives, God is about to use Joseph to forgive his brothers. But Joseph, he steps back into this place and he makes it so clear that this isn't something that is mine to give or that I have to give or that I figured out on my own. This is something God can and will do through us. In the same way that you hear me say it over and over again, remember who you are and whose you are. Y'all, we also have to remember who we're not. You're not God. I am not God. And I don't get to walk around in this life deciding who's worthy of forgiveness. I don't get to walk around in this life deciding who is more greatly to be blamed. I get to, don't miss this, I get to walk around in this life a recipient of the extreme forgiveness and grace of God. Because even though I've gotten it wrong more times than I can count, even though I've held on and I've pushed away and I've blamed and I've lied and I've cheated and I've done so many things, Jesus says, you are forgiven. And so in this radical declaration of Jesus, we walk around in the world as people who don't forgive because of somebody else's worthiness, but we forgive because we have been forgiven. It really has nothing to do with the person who wronged us. This is a question I get almost more than any other in my life in ministry. Is how do we forgive? And y'all, it's not easy. I don't mean to sound like it's easy, but I do want you to hear me say that it has almost nothing to do with the person who may have wronged you. It has everything to do with whether you can put yourself in the place of forgiven. Because for some of you right now, the person you need to forgive the most is yourself. You skipped right over the first goat, but it doesn't mean that that goat's not there. It doesn't mean that there are pieces that you've been responsible for. Because you didn't know how to deal with them, you pushed them away. And God's inviting you and me into this place of, you're not God. You don't get to decide if you're worthy of forgiveness. Jesus got to decide, and he did when he let himself be put on a cross. You're not in control of your worthiness to be forgiven. God is, and it's finished. And y'all, for the ones that we're hanging on to from somebody else, once you've walked in to the incredible forgiveness that God has for you, man, why not pass it along to someone else? Put everything else on the goat and send it into the woods. But there's so much more to life in a different way. When life goes wrong, it's okay to be mad, to be frustrated, to be angry. I've been all of those things this week. It's okay to be those things. But we can't stay there. Jesus made a way for us to not stay there, to not be stuck. For lack of a better way to say it, it's because he is the goat. He is the one who came and replaced all of the crazy practices that we look at and go, what even was happening back there in the Levitical days? Jesus came once and for all as the atonement for our sins, for your sins, for my sins, and for the sins of the many. Truth, grace, and forgiveness. Y'all, the only real option in front of us when life goes wrong. Truth, grace, forgiveness. And it's found in Jesus. And so I'm taking a lot of comfort in these days that I don't stand in the place of God. There's too much I don't understand. Thank goodness I don't stand in the place of God. But the God who is, and the God who does, chooses mercy over his people. When life goes wrong, God says, I'm with you, I'm for you, and we don't have to stay in this place. Let's pray. God, we're not good at asking for forgiveness and knowing how to even understand all the ways we've gone wrong and we struggle so much with forgiving other people. But God, we want to be people who can embrace the forgiveness that you've given to us in such a way that it's just a gift we get to keep passing along. God, I pray for every person who is listening to this today, who has found themselves stuck in one of these places, who's hearing that call today to let it go, to find a way, to send it away, to look at things truthfully, and then to receive the grace that you're so ready to give. And so God, I pray right now for every one of us, for every one of us, that we would receive that offer, that we wouldn't stand here holding on to the mess when you're ready to make it a miracle. God, let today be the day that we open up ourselves again to write the story of our lives, because you are the master and the creator and the one who loves us so very much. God, we're grateful, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus, who gave everything, including himself, for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. All my failures I tried. of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good. you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh.